My name is Juan Pablo Arias Munoz. I am a writer-director from Chile, the director of The Curse of the Necklace. When I first read the script, the first thing that stood out to me visually to tackle was this concept of the void. In the script, it was just merely described as the void, but there wasn't any much more detail to it. So that was another element that visually we had to kind of build from the ground up. There wasn't much reference to what that needed to be.
From the very beginning, we were playing with the idea that the void inside of the necklace was this area where the souls were trapped. And that over time, these souls would become ash. And so adding this ash floating into the air inside of the void, that created kind of like this mystery, but also intrigue, that these weren't the first souls that were trapped in the void, and they wouldn't be the last.
I think the creation of a world is something that was new to me. I wouldn't say it was particularly challenging because I felt very supported by the team. I think everybody was very excited to try it. So beyond the logistical challenges, it didn't really seem like too much of a problem as much as something that we needed to execute and we needed to get right. I think understanding what the world was before you shoot it, I think that was something new. I think it was interesting to kind of experience when you kind of have to talk to an actor about what they see around them and how to react to a world around them that is not really there. That was an interesting aspect of the work. We shot at a stage, and the void world wasn't there. When we first started talking about the world of the void with Connor in pre-production, we spent time talking about what we wanted, and Connor made a few concept art of what we wanted the void world to be.
We really just went back and forth pitching ideas of what the void would look like. You know, what would it feel like to be inside of the void? We started out with creating the inside of a ruby with like these really reflective walls, and kind of went from there to create it more expansive and feel less claustrophobic. Really just working on a still image.
That concept art, that one image that we all kind of agreed and we liked, and you know, we were able to show the producers what we wanted to do and helped us sort of sell this world that we wanted to do. Also helped with the actors, because when we wanted to talk about the void, you know, it was a question whenever we would read the script with them. It's like, what is this void thing? What does it look like? It was very, very helpful to have this concept art and to tell them, we're gonna shoot this on a stage and we are designing this world around you. So whenever they were on set and they were looking around and they were, using their facial expressions to show us their sense of awe, the whole team, we really made a push for creating this like completely new world that doesn't really exist in reality. These were all sequences that we identified early in the process, and we created storyboards for those sequences. And then Connor, our wonderful visual effects supervisor, he took those storyboards that I, you know, just drew on my iPad, and he made them animatics. And then we discussed, you know, the shots and the way the world worked around the shots, and came up with some ideas in that process. So that really allowed us to see the scene before we actually had to create the world or shoot it. So those three scenes throughout the film where you kind of go into the void, those are all scenes that were heavily, you know, pre-visualized and that we developed.
A super fun and creative process of finally getting to see it in motion. We'd been talking about it for weeks, but this was the first time we really got to see it all put together, and we could really feel what the environment was going to feel like.
That sequence in particular, the sequence of the possession as well, was something that we spent a lot of time on, that there was a storyboard and then there was an animatic, and then that animatic allowed me and Connor and Ruben, the director of photography, to to have a conversation about what did we need. And I think there's several scenes in the film that need the realism of the circumstances to come through and for us to understand. First, understand with clarity what's going on, and second, to kind of jolt you out of, you know, normalcy. I think that's what visual effects do so well. I think especially in a film where we do a little bit of a hybrid, not all the effects are practical and not all the effects are visual. So I think this kind of walking this line in between those two, and you don't really know what if you're looking at a visual effect or if you're looking at a practical effect.
One of the earlier conversations that we had was talking about what would be done in practical effects and what would be done in visual effects. Really just talking a lot about the limitations of what can be done in visual effects. And really trying to find that sweet spot of figuring out where we could blend those two together and create something that felt truly horrifying.
There's a scene where a ghost that appears to one of the girls vomits blood over one of them, and that was something that was achieved in visual effects. So that scene didn't have that visual effect for a long time in the process, and then once that was incorporated, then the scene just kind of caught fire in a sense that it really became something different and much more scary and much more intense.
Oftentimes what happens in visual effects is really invisible because you try to enhance the work that they were able to accomplish on set through practical effects. This is one of those shots from the get-go that we knew that we wanted to have a very visceral feel to it. And oftentimes in order to get that really realistic feel of blood, the best way to do it is just to shoot it for real. So we actually filmed a lot of our own blood assets for this to really help amp up all of those shots and make them feel more visceral and make them feel more dangerous.
So there was a couple of times where on set the practical effects didn't go as planned. And you know, that's something that it happens. It's just part of the challenges of shooting, the challenges of production, basically. Luckily, you know, Connor was always on set, and he would be available to brainstorm with us in the moment how we could solve those issues later.
I think that's just something that happens when you're filming, is that you're not always able to capture everything inside of camera. And I think that's our job as visual effects artists, is to try to think creatively outside of the box and come up with solutions that can help tell you those story elements. And I think that, you know, whether an effect is done practically or through visual effects, I think that's our job, is just to service the story and help tell that story for the film.
That it's not just about this one shot, this one effect. For as much as you want to get this, you know, we had some problems with a blood pump that was supposed to pump blood through sheets that never worked. And also another scene in which there was a bookcase that was supposed to fall, and that took way too much time to set up, and it didn't work practically either. Luckily, we had our VFX supervisor on set who could help us understand what we needed from production to be able to solve those things later. And then replacing the bookcase that we originally had on set with a 3D asset that was also, you know, a suggestion from Connor, and it looks seamless on the screen. A lot of the effects that, you know, that we did some practical stuff when, you know, when Laura gets lifted off the ground, but a lot of that wasn't there, and it was just, you know, a set. There were lights, there was equipment in the shots, and you kind of just had to rely on your team, you had to rely on the process, and you had to trust the process that at the end of the process you would get what you needed from the shot. So that was I think not particularly challenging, but it was an interesting aspect of what we did in this movie. The look of the film is something you develop over time, you know, in the different conversations you have with the department heads, the different conversations you have with, you know, with the writer, with the producers, you kind of have some ideas of what you want, or really you have, at least in my process, you have a path you want to follow. You have a certain aesthetic that you'd like to, you know, pursue or achieve or explore. I think I said it's more of an exploration than something that you kind of write on paper and then you just execute. As a director, you have to remain open to ideas and possibilities and, you know, curveballs. And really the job is, how do you make the best with what you have and really trust your team to come up with solutions for, you know, the endless creative problems that you get along the way.
Well, that's kind of what visual effects is. It's creative problem solving and coming up with solutions to help tell the story the best way it can be.
I think my advice to young filmmakers would be to always stay creative, always stay working. If you are a writer, then write. If you're a director, then direct. Take every opportunity that you can to grab a camera and to make a short, to make a music video. And when you have done this and you have spent your time working a lot on your own and understanding your tools and exercising your craft, then opportunities will come and you'll be able to show what you know. And if you're prepared for those opportunities, then other opportunities will come from there. I think the most important thing as a young filmmaker is to use your time, write, direct, stay creative, and always stay creative. Never put your arms down, because you never know when the opportunities are going to arise, and you want to be ready for those moments.
Well, I hope you guys enjoyed this special look at the behind the scenes of the visual effects for The Curse of the Necklace. The film is coming out soon to theaters, so make sure to go watch that. If you guys enjoyed this video, make sure to hit the subscribe button below. On this channel, I try to create weekly videos of the behind the scenes as a visual effects supervisor and filmmaker in Hollywood. And I hope you guys learn just as much as I do along my journey. I'll see you guys again next week with another video. Till then, stay creating.